Hello dear students, welcome to this EPG Paathshala module, and myself Ganga Sahai Meena, I welcome you all on this particular module. In this module we are going to discuss under the paper applications in food science and technology, and the module name is microfiltration, nanofiltration, ultrafiltration and RO, as well as their industrial applications. So we are going to learn about these four classical membrane processes. These are traditional membrane processes, or you can say pressure driven membrane processes, and their industrial application in the food processing. Okay. So in this module you are going to learn about the basic family of all the available separation processes which are used to separate different modules, followed by the membrane, its types, as well as about the characteristics of different membrane modules. That which are the, what is membrane, which are different modules, what are the characteristics of these four modules, what is their configuration, working principle, operation parameters, separation behavior, membrane pore size, and limitation factor of these four well-known classical pressure driven membrane processes, usually referred as membrane filtration processes, namely microfiltration, ultrafiltration, nanofiltration, and reverse osmosis, are explained and compared with each other. Various industrial application of this process is also provided. So the objective of this particular module is first to learn about the main four classical membrane process, namely that is microfiltration, ultrafiltration, nanofiltration and reverse osmosis. So we are going to learn about these four membrane process in detail, that what is their characteristics, how they are working, which are the different configurations used for the operation of these type of membrane processes. Introduction. In separation process, different substances of a solution is separated into their individual forms. Single or multiple principles are used to separate a target molecule. A complete family of these processes are available, in which membrane filtration is mainly used for molecular separation. As shown in table 1 is showing family of different separation processes, and here we can see that in the left corner, the first is the mechanical separation by gravity. Under this, two types of separation are coming: sedimentation, so the sediment is taking place at the bottom, and another is the flotation. Next is the mechanical separation by centrifugal force, like separators and decanters or hydrocyclones. Next is the separation by phase change, like evaporation, in which like water is evaporating and condensed solids are remaining. Drying, that is also a type of separation by phase change, crystallization and distillation. Next is the separation by extraction, like liquid, it may be solid liquid or it may be supercritical, where the CO2 is used as a most common solvent after water. Very frequently used is water, but this, in this case, supercritical food extraction, normally CO2 is used because it is next to water in the utilization as a solvent, because it is easily available and is cheaper also. Now coming to the molecular separation. So molecular separation means we are going towards this micron size, and we already knowing that this membrane separation is usually conducted when the particle size is less than 10 micron. So under this, four membrane separation process are used, namely reverse osmosis, nanofiltration, ultrafiltration and microfiltration, and these all are known as pressure driven separation systems, which are mainly used in dairy industry. And next are dialysis, electrodialysis, gas separation, pervaporation, chromatography and ion exchange. There may be other types of separation also, like conventional filtration, that is deaded filtration, and separation by absorption, like activated carbon is also used for the separation. Membrane is the key component of these pressure driven processes, which act as a selective barrier, as well as passes and retains the molecules based on number of mechanisms. It can be thick or thin. It means the membrane can be thick or thin. It may be homogeneous or heterogeneous. Membrane may be symmetric or asymmetric or composite, dense or porous, neutral or charged,
natural or synthetic. Synthetic can be of inorganic and organic, and molecules transferred through these membranes can be active or passive, which may be driven by the difference in the temperature, pressure and concentration. Different generation of membrane materials are existing currently, which delivers the improved separation capability and resistance toward operational parameters. Further, these membranes materials can be fixed into different membrane modules or elements defined as the smallest entity of the membrane that can be exchanged. It means this is the definition for the membrane module. And these are normally given by four names. These are platen frame, spiral bound, hollow fiber and tubular to accomplish the desired separation task. Each membrane molecule can be used in one or more than one membrane process like RO, NF, VF and NF. That means single module can be used for one or more processes but has its own advantage and disadvantage. Pictographic representation of these membrane modules are shown in figure 1. In this pictographic representation of all four membrane modules of configuration are shown in figure 1, while their typical characteristics are shown in table 2 that we will discuss later on. So in this figure, first A is the spiral bound membrane module, B is the hollow fiber membrane module, C is the platen frame membrane module and D is the tubular membrane module. So first we focus on the spiral bound membrane module. So in which in this particular spiral bound membrane module, what is there that we are having a layer of membrane, then we are placing a feed channel spacer, and then we are placing a support material, and all these things are closed from three ends, and it is just formed like an envelope, and finally it is rolled. So in center of this, the feed will be given, and there will be a tube that is perforated that will collect the permeate from all these layers, and retained will be another side of the membrane, and finally we will get the permeate and concentrate. In figure B, this is the hollow fiber, so it's simpler. We are having number of tube or this hollow fibers of this membrane. So from one side we are sending feed, and in the another side we are getting rotated on the basis of the pore size of this membrane, and permeate will come out. C is the platen frame design of membrane. So it works like usually or the classical plate exchanger, but here rather than the gaskets we are having different membranes in this. And D is the tubular membrane, in which we are having a saline tube type arrangement, and there is a membrane bundle, and outside the membrane bundle there is SS perforated tubes. So when the feed is subjected to this type of membrane module, the separation will take place and the permeate will come out, and retentive will be retained in the membrane module, so that finally from one end we are removing permeate and from another end we are removing retentive. So table 2 shows the characteristics of common membrane configurations, and here the characteristics are channel size in mm, packing density that is given by area divided by volume meter square per meter cube, flux that is given in lmh, energy consumption, cost per unit area, then membrane replacement cost, holder volume, fouling, backflushing, CIP and polymer choices. So we see in comparative, then we can see that channel size in mm, so hollow fiber having 0.6 to 1.1 mm, platen frame is having 0.5 to 1 mm, spiral bond is having 0.86 to 1.52, while tubular based on polymeric that is having 12.7 to 25.4 mm, and tubular in inorganic waste that is a mineral membranes, these are having 2 to 19 mm. Packing density for this hollow fiber is 1000 to 10,000 meter square per meter cube, platen frame 200 to 400, spiral bond 300 to 1000, and for tubulars it's ranging from 100 to 300. So from this is an important point that packing density, if certain membrane module is having higher packing density, it means higher area can be fixed in a lesser volume, or higher volume can be fixed in a lesser area. So it is very high for hollow fiber. It means hollow fiber membranes are needing very less space, while tubular membranes are needing the highest space. Flux is fair or poor for the hollow fiber, excellent and good for platen frame, good for spiral bond, and for tubular also it is good. energy consumption, hollow fibers runs on very low pressure, platelet frame, it varies from medium to high, and for this spiral bound and tubular membranes, it may vary from low to high, medium or high. Cost per unit area, cost per unit area low for hollow fiber, high for platelet frame, low for spiral bound, and high or very high for polymeric. But if we are using this mineral membrane, then the cost will be very high. Membrane replacement cost moderate in hollow fiber, low in platelet frame, low in spiral bond, and tubular having very high, high to very high membrane replacement cost. Holdup volume is very low for hollow fiber, medium for platelet frame and spiral bond type of module, and high for tubular membrane module. Fouling, very high fouling is observed in hollow fiber membrane module, while medium fouling is observed in platelet frame and spiral bond, and high or medium fouling is observed in tubular membrane. In the case of this fouling, tubular membranes are ranging from low to medium. Back flushing, this capability that when the membrane is fouled, so we are connecting external pipe and we are pressurizing the permeate from outside, it will remove the blocking or clogging of the membrane. This facility is only available in the hollow fiber membrane module. Otherwise, this platelet frame and spiral bond are not having this. Tubular polymeric also not having this, but in case of tubular inorganic membrane, this is equipped with this facility. CIP, that is clean in place, good for hollow fiber, platelet frame no, spiral bond no, tubular polymeric no, but it is highly suited for the tubular inorganic membrane. Polymer choice, for hollow fiber few, platelet frame many, spiral bond also many, and few for tubular based polymeric, and there are no polymer is used for the manufacture of tubular inorganic membrane. Reason, because these membranes are manufactured from the mineral membranes. Other comments, that hollow fiber can't withstand very high pressure, while this tubular membrane, particularly based on ceramics, is highly resistant toward pH, temperature and chemicals. Tubular based on polymeric, it also can't handle high solids content. If we see the platelet frame, then permeate from membrane elements can be monitored separately. In case of spiral bond membrane, mass spacer creates dead spots to flow, and in such type of membrane, this is a problem. Cleaning is also a little bit problem.
In this slide, we are going to discuss about the membrane processes and membrane filtration. So, membrane processes have several inbuilt vital or key characteristics like effectiveness, easiness, compactness, cleanliness, lower energy consumption, because they are very low in energy consumption. The reason is that they are only consuming energy in the form of pump operation. So, membrane plant is equipped with a certain type of centrifugal pumps. So, electricity is mainly consumed for the operation of pumps. Moreover, flexible production capacity. So, we can produce higher amount also with the membrane, and we can produce little amount also. The reason that how much membrane area we are fixing in a particular type of module, on the basis of that, how much flux we are getting, on that basis, the production capacity of the membrane plants is given. Better selectivity of the desired molecules, because these are separation processes, as well as compatibility with other membrane oriented and conventional process. So we can use one membrane system with another membrane system. Like if we are using ultra filtration, we can couple it with the nano filtration. We can use microfiltration in combination with the reverse osmosis. So we can couple these membrane processes with each other, and we can also couple them with other processes. Like for example, suppose we want to produce powder, milk powder, and for the concentration purpose, we know that for the production of milk powder, we need to raise the total solids content from initial to around 50%. So suppose we are going to produce SMP, skim milk powder, then we are having around 8 to 9% TS in the skim milk. We need to raise it up to 50% TS. So first we are using reverse osmosis process, that is a membrane process. So in this reverse osmosis, one part, that skim milk from 9% total solids to we are increasing up to 25% total solids. And then we are coupling this RO reverse osmosis process with classical evaporation. So we are increasing this TS from 25 to 50% with the help of classical evaporation. So in this way, they can be coupled with the either membrane process, or they can be coupled with other classical process. Their integrity and ever increasing stability towards the pH. as we are knowing that there are three till now there are three or four membrane generations, so the their sensitivity toward pH in first generation is only 3 to 8 pH range, which is applicable in second generation is by Biden, and in the third generation where the mineral membrane comes into the picture, we can operate them into full pH range 0 to 14, and pressure, temperature and environmental factor makes them highly suitable for multi-purpose application in an array of industrial products. So detailed classification of key membrane processes are present in table 3, which we will discuss, while size ranges of membrane filtration process and common substances are shown in figure 2.
Table 3 shows the classification of membrane separation processes. So here different things are given, like characteristics which includes membrane thickness, pore size, driving force, and which are the components that are rejected and what type of membrane material is used. And these are the four processes: MF, UF, NF and RO. So membrane in MF normally symmetrical or asymmetric type of membrane is used. In UF mainly asymmetrical. Also in NF asymmetric membrane is used. In the case of reverse osmosis, asymmetric as well as composite membrane is used. Thickness in micron. So this is S means sublayer, and here T denotes the top layer. So it vary from 10 to 150 micron, 150 to 250 micron in the case of UF, and 150 in the case of NF, and around 150 and top layer of 1 mm in the case of reverse osmosis. Here driving force, that is the pressure. So in microfiltration it is less than 2 bar. In case of ultrafiltration is 1 to 10 bar. In nanofiltration it is 5 to 40 bar, and in reverse osmosis 10 to 100 bar. So this range of applied pressure is varying, and you will find different values for this applied pressure in different notebooks for these four classical membrane processes. Which are the products which are rejected? So microfiltration reject particles, clay and bacteria. Ultrafiltration are rejecting macromolecules, proteins, polysaccharides and viruses. Nanofiltration is rejecting high molecular weight components, mono and di oligosaccharides, polyvalent ions. And reverse osmosis is rejecting high molecular weight component and low molecular weight component, like sodium, chloride, glucose, amino acid and proteins. Membrane materials, so like ceramics, polysulfone, PBDF. In the case of UF polymers, polysulfone. Polysulfone is the membrane material which is widely used in the dairy industry, and particularly for the ultrafiltration membrane. NF, this CTA, and for this RO, cellulose and polyamide membrane is also used. Membrane module which are available for this process, so for microfiltration, tubular, hollow fiber, spiral bond and platen frame. Again for UF, tubular, hollow fiber, spiral bond and platen frame, and all the modules are used in NF and RO also. This main application of microfiltration is analytical applications like crystallization of foods and pharmaceuticals, clarification of beverages, cell harvesting in the biotechnology. UF, particularly in dairy, milk, whey and cheese making. So it is used as a protein concentration process, or while this MF is protein fractionation process. Food, it is used for potato starch and proteins. Clarification of fruit, vegetable and vegetable oils. Pharmaceutical, it is used for enzyme, antibiotics and cryogens, and it's also used for the water treatment. Nanofiltration is used for the concentration of fruit juice, demineralization of the water, sugar solutions and whey. This is one of the important use that we can produce different whey-based powders, but these are lacking minerals. Recycling of nutrients in fermentation process, separation of sunflower oil and solvent, treatment of wastewater. RO, it is used for concentration of dairy products, concentration of fruit juice and sugar, and desalination of the breakers and seawater, production of ultra-pure water in the power industry. Figure 2 shows the size ranges of membrane filtration process and common substances. So in this figure, we can see in the bottom of this figure that what is the size of these filtration process, and in this range, which are the different other substances that are coming. Like this practical filtration. So this is able to separate the particles which are visible to naked eye. Classical separation. Classical filtration is able to separate the particles which is visible to naked eye, and or maybe they can be seen by the optical microscope. So it mainly contains macro particles range and micro particles range. If we talk about the microfiltration, then it is normally used in the molecular and micro particles range, like absorbents, this pigment and emulsions. Ultrafiltration is used in molecular and macromolecular range, like which is seen by the SEM, scanning electron microscope. And nanofiltration is used in the molecular range, that is ranging from 0.001 to 0.01. And reverse osmosis, that is also known as hyperfiltration, is always used in ionic range. So here, if we see this units in angstrom, then or log scale, then this reverse osmosis is used for 0.001. RO and NF, that is NF is used in the range of 0.001 to 0.01. Ultrafiltration is for 0.1. Likewise, in this slide, figure 3 shows the principle of membrane filtration as well as separation by the four pressure driven membrane process. So in figure A, we can see that there are four processes like microfiltration, UF, NF and RO, and the applied pressure for MF is less than 1 bar, UF 1 to 10 bar, nanofiltration 20 to 50 and reverse osmosis 30 to 60 bar. And which are the particles that are retained and passed, that has been shown in this arrow, that bacteria is in the blue color, bacteria and fat, protein in a green color, lactose in violet color, minerals in red color, water in the this sky blue color. So here we can see that in the case of microfiltration, only bacteria, fat and some of the proteins will be retained, otherwise everything will pass. If we coming to the ultrafiltration, then all the proteins and water will be retained, this fat will be retained, otherwise all things, other things which are mineral, water and lactose will be passed. If coming to the nanofiltration, then here we can see all the bacteria, fat as well as proteins and lactose will be retained, while some of the salts will be passing and water will be passing. If we are coming to the reverse osmosis, only water will pass, otherwise all the things will be retained. And why these four membrane process are showing different types of separation behavior, that depend on the membrane pore size. So here you can see the another RO that is coming downwards, that the size of reverse osmosis is 10 to power minus 4 to 10 to power minus 3 in micron. In case of NF, it is 10 to power minus 3 to 10 to power minus 2. In UF, it is 10 to power minus 2 to 10 to power minus 1. And in microfiltration, it is 10 to power minus 1 to 10 to power plus 1. So it is based on the membrane pore size, because the separation or the retention of the different type of particles in these membrane processes are normally based on the membrane pore size. In figure B, it is also showing that will be the permeate and what will be the retentate. So in case of what is the pore size, what is the pressure range. In figure B, we can see that in the case of microbes, which things are bacteria and suspended solids are retained, your pressure is up 1 to 3 bar. UF, the pressure may be 3 to 10 bar. NF, the pressure may be 20 to 40 bar. And reverse osmosis, here the pressure will be determined as per the osmotic pressure of the solution. So normally this whey and milk are having 7 bar osmotic pressure, and here only water will be passing, otherwise all the things will be retained by the reverse osmosis process.
Okay, in this slide we are going to discuss about the microfiltration. So microfiltration is among the four pressure driven classical membrane processes. We are knowing that these are MF, UF, NF and RO. So where it stands? So it is stands between the coarse filtration. If we see the total filtration spectrum, then it stands with the coarse filtration and ultrafiltration. So it is standing between both of these processes, either coarse filtration or ultrafiltration processes. Among these processes, this microfiltration is having openest pore size. That's why the applicable pressure is lowest for this microfiltration. And another thing that it can be operated in dead end filtration, that we are adding something one stream and some another thing is coming out, which we have seen in the another lecture also, or the Ipatsala module also, that we are pouring our feed and this is a membrane and permeate is coming out, retention will be over this and the cake layer formation will take place. Another module is the cross flow filtration, in which we are adding the feed but diagonally, and it is divided into three streams, that we are adding, we are feeding from this side, and this permeate will coming out and retentate will be going in that direction, and the accumulation of the solids on this surface, membrane surface, will be minimum. That will result in the better flux. So we can operate into dead end filtration, and we can operate it in the cross flow filtration also, it can be operated in the batch module and it can be operated in the continuous system also. So batch and continuous, dead end and cross flow, these are the things with the microfiltration. It is totally flexible. Moreover, when we are doing the microfiltration, for example say milk, then what will happen? What will be retained in the permeate and what will be going into the retentate? That will be based on the pore size of the membrane of microfiltration. What pore size we are using, on the basis of that the retention as well permeation characteristics will be varying. For example, suppose if we are using 10 micron pore size, or if we are using 1.4 micron pore size of the MF membrane, then it will be not able to fractionate the casings. But at the same time, if we are using 0.1 micron this MF membrane, then it will fractionate casein and whey proteins. Usually this milk fat, micronism, somatic cells, these are retained in the retentate in the case of microfiltration, while protein, lactose and other salts are going to the permeate. Moreover, this is interesting that in the case of microfiltration, this retentate is not our desired product. Normally our desired product, if we are going for the microfiltration of milk to enhance its shelf life, then the permeate is our desired product. Normally other membrane processes are having retentate as a desired product, but in this case opposite is true. So we can produce different substances like this extended shelf life milk, and other things also can be produced with the help of microfiltration.
Proper control of transmembrane pressure, that is given by TMP, and plugging of pores are the key limiting factors during microfiltration. For dead end filtrations, the difference between feed pressure, that is given by PF, and the pressure on the permeate side of the membrane, which is given by PP, is the transmembrane pressure. So for dead end filtration, the transmembrane pressure will be the will be given by the formula, that is TMP equal to PF minus PP. But for cross flow filtration, the same is given by another formula, that is PF plus PR divided by 2 minus PP. Here PR is the retentate pressure and PF is the feed pressure, while the PP is the permeate side pressure. So during MF processing, TMP must be as low as possible, or it should be less than 1 bar to reduce membrane fouling or pore plugging and to achieve better filtration efficiencies. So this is one of the critical factor during the operation of microfiltration process, that the transmembrane pressure, like for tubular membranes, it should be less than 1 bar, or it should be strictly followed as per the manufacturer's guidelines to avoid the fouling of the membrane as well as to get the higher efficiency in flux. Microfiltration has several applications in different industries. In dairy industry, this microfiltration membranes, which are having different pore size like 0.8 and 1.4 micron mean pore diameter, is used for bacteria and spore removal from homogenized whole milk. So Alpha Level utilize this concept, and the Alpha Level company has developed a process called Bacto Catch system using this membrane, particularly MF membrane. Its industrial application includes production of cheese milk, particularly that in which none of the these microbes which are undesired for cheese making, and other antibiotics and some somatic cells will be removed, as well as extended shelf life milk, in which we are removing the microbes in the retentate, then we are heat treating it, and again we are adding to the milk and packing it aseptically. Or microfiltered drinking milk using 1.4 micron MF membrane. It is also used for the removal of thermostable enzymes and somatic cells as a pre-treatment during UHT milk production. MF have great potential for fat fractionation in near future. It is used for the fractionation of sweet cream buttermilk as well as whey buttermilk for the isolation of MF GM, that is milk fat globular membrane, which is having significant role as a nutraceutical or functional ingredient. In cheese making, it is used for bacteria removal, casein content, and alpha casein to beta casein ratio adjustment, recovery of fat and brine from water. In whey processing, microfiltration is used for bacteria and fat removal using 0.1 and 1.4 micron MF membranes, whey proteins free skim milk as well as ultra low heat skim milk are being produced. It is also used for the recovery of casein micropeptide, that is CMP, and several other industrial applications of microfiltration is shown in table 6, which we will discuss later on. Ultrafiltration. The term ultrafiltration was initially coined by Wechold. It is widely used membrane process in dairy and food industries. Pore size of UF membranes is in the range of 0.001 to 0.01 micron. Is lesser than MF but greater than NF and RO. The applied pressure during ultrafiltration is between 1 to 10 bar as shown in table and figure 3. The UF process membranes are both popular and characterized on the basis of molecular weight cutoff rather than pore size. Several membrane manufacturers use molecular weight cutoff as a criteria to assess the membrane separation efficiency. For ultrafiltration, if the MWCO ranges from 100 to 200 kilodalton, it means it can retain the components 80% up to this molecular weight range. Or we can say that suppose if my ultrafiltration process is having 50 kDa membrane with it, then it will be retaining, it will be able to retain 80 to 90% components of that molecular weight. That is the meaning of this kDa or molecular weight cutoff classification of the ultrafiltration membranes. Generally, for a given molecular cutoff, 80% of the molecules of that molecular weight will be rejected. This process is well known as a protein concentration and fractionation process. During ultrafiltration, only water, lactose or the sugars, minerals and vitamins moves in permeate, but fat, bacteria and proteins are retained in the retentate as well as concentrated in the retentate. So it means it is used as a concentration process for the particularly this protein and fats. Gel formation over the membrane surface, concentration polarization and membrane fouling are the main limiting factors during ultrafiltration. So concentration polarization is the condition where the accumulation of different feed solids will take place over the surface of the membrane, while membrane fouling is the interaction between the membrane as well as the feed components. So these are detrimental for the flux. Ultrafiltration can be performed in all modules or configurations. In dairy industry, ultrafiltration is used for protein content sterilization in cheese milk, high protein milk, fermented products like dahi and curd or yogurt, chakka and srikhand or kumis. During cheese making, UF is used to protein content adjustment, production of soft variety of cheeses like cream, quark and ricotta. Ultrafiltration has enabled the dairy industry to convert its whey, which is produced in huge quantities, into a series of value-added products. In whey processing, UF is being employed for concentration, fractionation, defatting and demineralization to produce whey protein concentrated, whey protein isolates. Different whey protein fractions like immunoglobulins and growth factors, UF is the only process used for the concentration of total milk proteins in skim milk for the production of milk protein concentrate and milk protein isolates. Different industrial application of ultrafiltration is also shown in table 6 that we will discuss later on.
In this slide, we are going to discuss about the industrial application of all membrane processes, namely microfiltration, ultrafiltration, nanofiltration and reverse osmosis. So numerous application of membrane-based processes which are either established or developing in different industries like dairy applications, food and beverage applications and or this oil refining, pharmaceutical application, purification of nutraceuticals, and these are their industrial applications are given in detail on the official website of GF Filtrations. Moreover, all these has been discussed in table 6 and 7. Moreover, different application of these processes has been also given in the paper 2 and module 34. So students, you are requested to see that module for the other applications. Namely, if you just want to go in brief that which are the major applications of these membrane processes, then we can go by a reverse osmosis, that it is normally used for the concentration process. NF, that is also known as loose RO process, that is used for concentration as well as fractionation, because in this we are removing different salts, so it's a demineralization process. If we come to the ultrafiltration process UF, then here we are, what we are doing, we are using it as a concentration process, but it is only applicable for the this milk proteins or some other proteins. So it is concentrating the proteins. If you come to the this microfiltration, in dairy industry I am talking about, so it is used for the removal of bacteria, fat, and production of extended shelf life milk, so and fractionation of proteins also. Reverse osmosis, it is term, this reverse osmosis term was coined in 1931 during granting of a patent for water salting. Operation pressure 30 to 60 bar is highest for this membrane process among all this classical pressure driven processes. The pore size of RO membrane is in the range of 10 to power minus 4 to 10 to minus power minus 3 micron, which is lower than the pore size of MF, UF and NF. Only water can pass through the RO membrane. RO process is most widely used in water industry for drinking water, wastewater treatment, as well as desalination of the brackish water and sea water. In dairy and fruit juice and beverage application, it is used as the most economical pre-concentration process till osmotic pressure limits reaches, which mainly depends on the osmotic pressure of the feed component. Further concentration of the feed beyond this limit in RO process make this process uneconomical. So it means that this RO process or the concentration in RO process is mainly governed by the osmotic process of the feed. Moreover, it is efficient and economical concentration process for heat sensitive products. If a vessel equipped with the semi permeable membrane is filled with the two different solutions of varying concentration, then the water of less concentrated solution will pass through the membrane into the solution with the higher concentration, that is due to the osmotic pressure difference, to get the equilibrium. If external pressure, which is higher than the solution's osmotic pressure, is applied on the higher concentration solution, then the movement of water can be reversed. It means now water will flow from higher concentration solution to the lower concentration solution, which will result in increasing the concentration of previously concentrated solution and further dilution of the less concentrated solution. It means concentrated solution will become concentrated and dilute solution will become diluted. This phenomena is called reverse osmosis. And the basis for RO process, for which osmotic pressure is the main limiting factor, different other proposed mechanism for the water transport in RO process is given in table 5. Here table 5 shows proposed mechanism of transport through RO membrane, and which has been given by Gerard and Fukumoto in year 2000. Mechanisms, there are four different mechanisms, like four or five. This solution diffusion, molecular sieve, vapor pressure, preferential sorption, and hydrogen binding. So these are the different mechanisms by which the separation or the operation of RO process is taken place. So if you take the example of solution diffusion, so what is the principle behind is that the solvent dissolve preferentially in the membrane and pass by the diffusion. If we see the another mechanism, vapor pressure, that the fine capillaries in the membrane prevent passage of solvent, but distillation can take place from the low to higher concentration. If we see hydrogen winding, then water makes hydrogen bond with the membrane and diffuse through the membrane. This is another approach or mechanism of the processing in RO. And next is the dielectric exclusion. It includes an ion in a pore will have a different dielectric field than an ion in solution, and statistically there is a lower probability of an ion being in a pore than in solution. So ions will be excluded from the membrane, which shows industrial application of these four classical membrane based systems, I mean microfiltration, NF, NF and RO. So application of these membrane are increasing in different industries with rapid pace. Recently, this Akin and co-workers in year 2012 summarized both commercial application in their review, and the same has been incorporated in by the author in paper 2
module 34. Okay, this is this would be noted, please, that different application or the commercial application has been incorporated by me in paper 2 of module 34, which can be seen in that module. Main industrial application of membrane processes in the shown in table 6, and numerous application of membrane based processes which are either established or still developing in different industries like dairy applications, food and beverage applications, pharmaceutical applications and industrial applications are given in detail on official website of GF Filtrations. A few of them are shown in table 7. So first we will look at the table 6, that is showing the selected industrial application of membrane processes. If we take industrial sector and which are the different membrane processes which are used. So drinking water, we have already seen that the drinking water sector or the water industry as overall is having the highest utilization of the membrane. So for drinking water, NF, UF and RO is used. For demineralized water, RO and NF is used. Wastewater treatment, direct physical, mainly this MF, NF and RO is for MBR, MF and UF is used. For food industry like dairy, UF and RO is used. Meat, UF and RO is used. Fruit and vegetables, RO is grain milling, UF. If we see the fruit juices, MF, RO and UF is having higher uses. Similar is the case with the wine and brewery, MF, UF and RO. Enzyme purification, RO is used. Concentration of fermentation broth, MF is used. Single cell protein harvesting, MF and UF are being used. And for marine biotechnology, MF and UF is used. If we have a look on the medicinal, then controlled released of different drugs, UF is used. And hemodialysis, in this, normally this process is used for the purification of blood, RO and UF are being used. Table 7 shows the various applications of membrane filtration in different industries at a glance, which has been taken from the official website of ZIA. And here we can see that membrane processes are used in number of industries like chemical industry, fermentation and biotechnology, wastewater application, food and beverage industry and dairy industry. So in chemical industry, it is used for pigment, industrial gelation, metals recovery, industrial salts, paper adhesives and then liquor or vanillin. In case of fermentation and biotechnology, it is used for bacillus, lysozymes, lactic acid production, butyric acid production, citric acid production, acetic acid production, protease enzymes, cellulose enzymes, peroxidase enzymes, etc. In case of wastewater, it is used for dairy plants, it is used for lime process, recovery of stick water recovery, egg process. If we see the food and beverage industry, then it is used for food ingredients and flavors, deerglycerin of beer, soy milk whey, this aloe vera juice, grapefruit juice, strawberry juice, orange juice and many other. And it is also used for the this chicken blood, potato starch recovery. And if we have a look on the dairy industry, then it is used for skim milk concentration, whey processing, lactose recovery, evaporator and condensate recovery, fermentation and biotechnological brine, clarification, cleaning, chemicals, recovery, specialty product development, salt, whey processing, mozzarella, cheese manufacturing. And dairy industry, these membrane processes are now having a emerging or the future potential that these are used for the separation of the nutraceutical and the functional products or functional ingredients, particularly which are suited for the specialty group, or these are the novel products which are normally being consumed by a target group of the population for the disease fighting or disease combating purpose.
Now I am going to conclude this session, and in this we have learned about the different membrane processes, that is microfiltration, ultrafiltration, nanofiltration and reverse osmosis. What are the different types of the membrane which are used in these membrane processes, as well as we have known that which are the different configuration, what is the basic difference between these four membrane processes and how they are operated, which are the critical limiting factor for these processes, and what is the pressure range, what is the pore size of these four membrane processes. So what type of membrane process will be used for which particular separation task, that has been learned in this particular process. Another thing, that our aim to know the different industrial applications of these membrane processes. So we have covered in this that what is the application in food processing, what is the application in what is nutraceuticals and functional food, what is the application in dairy industry. So all these has been covered in this particular session or this e-module. Dear students, I thank you for your keen interest and patience learning of this particular module.